Welcome to the National Alopecia Areata Foundation's webinar, Maintaining Scalp Health for All with or Without Hair and Wigs. Joining us today is Dr. Maria Hordinsky, Professor of Dermatology at the University of Minnesota Medical School. And I'm Judy Williams, NAP Support and Education Director. Before we start the webinar, I'd like to cover a few housekeeping details. We have disabled chat for this webinar session. Please post your questions for Dr. Hordinsky in the Q&A section. You can do it throughout the webinar, and please keep your questions as general as possible for the benefit of all audience members. This webinar is being recorded, and all registrants will receive a link to the recording via email sometime tomorrow. Finally, please share your feedback with us after the webinar. A link to a short survey will pop up in the browser window. Please complete the survey there. This webinar is part of NAF's You Are Not Alone Education and Empowerment webinar series. NAF gratefully acknowledges the support provided for this webinar series by our partners, Pfizer, Eli Lilly and Company, and Sun Pharma. And thank you for joining us to today's webinar. Before we get started, I'd like to tell you a little bit about NAF and our mission. The National Alopecia Areata Foundation is a leading advocacy organization for alopecia areata. NAF's mission is to drive research to find a cure, an accessible treatment for alopecia areata, support those impacted, and educate the public about the disease. NAF's vision is an empowered community with the choice to embrace or live free of alopecia areata. To learn more about NAF support resources and research and advocacy activities, or to join us as an advocate or supporter, please visit our website at naf.org. I will share more about I will share more information about resources we have at NAF at the end of our webinar. And now on to today's webinar, Maintaining Scalp Health for All, with or without hair and wigs. We are very pleased to have Dr. Maria Hordinsky with us today. Dr. Hordinsky is a professor in the Department of Dermatology at the University of Minnesota Medical School and is also the director of the department's clinical research division. She is recognized for her expertise and research in hair diseases and the peripheral nervous system as it relates to hair follicle biology. She is a member of the American Academy of Dermatology Board of Directors and the Scarring Alopecia Foundation. She is also an honorary director of the American Hair Research Society and a NAF's Research Advisory Council member. Dr. Hordinsky also received the Leonard Tau Humanism in Medicine Award and has over 200 publications. She regularly lectures and teaches on hair diseases and divides her time between seeing patients with residents and medical students in her clinical practice associated with the University of Minnesota Physicians, doing clinical research, teaching, and administration. Dr. Hordinsky, thank you for being here, and I will turn it over to you.
Thank you so much, Judy, and to NAF for the opportunity to spend an hour or close to an hour with everyone this evening. So Judy is in charge of the slides, so we'll go to the next slide. So the topic today is maintaining scalp health for all, with or without hair and wigs. And we can go to the next slide. So in alopecia areata, I'm just gonna start over, I got interrupted for just a second by my good colleagues who've been working very hard this afternoon. So let me just start by saying again that alopecia areata is an autoimmune disease in which the hair follicle is targeted, and the hair follicle is targeted anywhere on the body. Tonight, we're just going to focus on the scalp. We're not gonna really focus on eyebrow hair loss or eyelash hair loss or body hair loss. We're going to think about scalp health and what it's like if you have two patches of alopecia areata, like on the left, multiple patches as shown in the upper right, complete total hair loss is shown on the lower left, or this pattern called ophiasis pattern or band-like loss of hair as shown in the lower right picture. Let's go to the next slide. And we know that alopecia areata not only affects adults, but it also affects teenagers and young children. And we have seen it in very, very young children. And you can see that some of our experiences in these particular pictures. So you see on the left, a young child with total hair loss. And you can start to appreciate when you look at that picture, there's a little bumpiness to this child's skin. It's not as smooth as you see in the second picture in the upper middle part, where the skin is very, very smooth. And then in the patient who has more extensive disease on the right, you see multiple patches that are coalescing. And then on the lower left, you begin to see again more extensive hair loss. But again, the scalp just doesn't look completely healthy. And then the middle picture on the lower part of this slide shows again that loss of hair in that frontal scalp region, but the scalp looks quite good in this particular picture. So let's go to the next slide. So let's start taking a look at what we see in clinic. So this is a young patient who has primarily at this time, what we call again, ophiasis alopecia areata. And you can see on these pictures, these little round dots in certain areas. And those reflect acne lesions. So we are starting to see in this patient that not only do they have alopecia areata that's affecting the hair follicle with that inflammatory infiltrate around the bulb region, but we're also getting acne. So now we have inflammation going on within that hair follicle structure. So we don't want to see that when we're working with our patients who have and colleagues who have alopecia areata. We want that scalp to be as healthy as possible. Next slide, please. And here's that person that you saw earlier where the light is shining on the top of the head. There's a little bit of reflection. But again, when you just look at this picture, you can start to see some acne lesions above that left ear on the at around, say, 2 or 3 o'clock. So again, hints that something's not quite right. So let's go to the next picture. And here we have a patient who is starting to regrow her hair, but in a very diffuse pattern. And you can see these round circles in this picture, like right in the middle, there are about 3 of them. And you also see on the hair, some material, say at around 12 to 1 o'clock. So this is a patient who wears a hair piece and has really worked with many prosthetic devices. I think the ones that are the most difficult for us to keep a healthy scalp on is when the prosthetic device is really glued to the scalp and stays there for several days. It's much easier to keep a healthy scalp if you are able to maneuver and lift the hair piece off and actually clean the scalp periodically. So at this point, in looking at this picture, you can see these round circles, all of which reflect some inflammation around the hair follicle. But then we have to start thinking about something else. And that is, people can become allergic to the metal clips or even the glue that is sometimes used to keep a prosthetic hair device on the scalp. And so if there is a spot on the head that continuously gets red and it just matches where a particular part of the wig fits on the skin or the partial hair piece, then you have to start thinking about allergic contact dermatitis. In some cases, it's to nickel. In other cases, it's to something within the glue substance itself. And we can go to the next slide. And here's a young gentleman where we see in clinic that he has facial acne. And then when you look at the scalp, the back part of the scalp behind the left ear looks pretty good on this picture, but you start looking at the scalp above the ear, the hair density is decreased and it's not smooth. There's a scale that's present there, along with some of the white hair related to his alopecia areata when the pigment cell transfer isn't completely normal. And we can go on to the next slide. So let's just think about this for a minute. So you have alopecia areata, let's say it's patchy, and your doctor is recommending a topical steroids and you're going to be putting something on your scalp. The person taking care of you may be doing injections into these patches. They then may tell you to use minoxidil topically, either 2% or 5%. More recently, we see less and less of topical immunotherapy with new drug development. But if you just step back and think about it, and let's just focus on minoxidil or Rogaine. If you're using Rogaine on a patch where you're also putting a topical steroid on, and you kind of layer things, you put one on and then the next one, and you don't clean your scalp for a few days, like say you're someone who shampoos once a week or twice a week, then there's a, oh, and then if you work out, and let's say you're a runner or you go to the gym a lot and you sweat a lot, then there's a high likelihood that the scalp health is going to deteriorate a little bit. So we have to all come up with solutions to keep that scalp healthy. And in the next few slides coming up, we'll discuss what we know and what people think. It may not be perfect yet, but it's getting better in terms of our knowledge base. So we can go to the next slide. So that brings us to these new medications that were recently approved, the first one a couple of years ago, and then another one last summer, and a third one this summer. And tonight's talk is not focused on these medications, but what I want to focus on are some of the side effects that can be seen when one is treated with a Janus kinase or JAK inhibitor. So this family consists of JAK1, JAK2, JAK3, and TYK2 receptors. We can go to the next slide. And we can go to the next slide, Judy, if it's moving. So what I wanted to bring out is that these JAKs are really quite young. They were identified in Australia in the laboratory in 1989, and then a second one was discovered in 1991. So then let's go to the next slide. So these move very quickly through the clinical research world. And the fact that we have three JAK inhibitors available to use and prescribe for patients with extensive alopecia areata is really remarkable. But what I want to focus on, if you look at baricitinib or Olumiant, and you look at the bullet points and you go to the third bullet point, excuse me, when you're on Olumiant, there's, from the clinical research studies, approximately 6% of patients can develop acne or worsening of their acne on the low dose. And on the higher dose at 4 milligrams, the percentage is about the same. And with ritlecitinib or Litfulo, the clinical research data would suggest that about 6.2% of patients develop acne. Now, in our experiences, both in the clinical trials and also in clinical practice, we're not seeing, or at least I'm not seeing, this acne type eruption on the scalp. But who knows? It might be that patients that we're treating are really taking good care of their scalp, or that acne is really more prominent when it occurs with the JAK inhibitors on the face. But just something to be aware of here, because acne, again, forms in that pilosebaceous unit or that hair follicle unit. And we can go to the next slide. So this is the third JAK inhibitor that was just approved this summer, the summer of 2024. And I think everyone is getting more real world experience with this particular JAK as time passes. And we can go on to the next slide. So why bring a COVID-19 survivor into this particular presentation? Well, during COVID, a lot of patients experienced hair loss, and there were many explanations, and I just want to discuss a couple of them. One was, if you get a viral illness, some people 3 to 6 months after a viral illness or an infection or a hospitalization can develop hair loss. It's like diffuse hair shedding. With COVID, what people started to see is that some people started to lose that hair and that shedding that occurred much earlier. So that was something unexpected. But then we can go to the next slide. And then there was this article in the Wall Street Journal that, and again, this is occurring during COVID, more cooking, less shampooing, the coronavirus consumer starts to emerge. And so companies that make shampoos, conditioners like Unilever, Procter & Gamble, and other consumer goods giants reported major shifts in shopper behavior amid lockdowns. And then we can go to the next slide. Because people quit taking care of their scalp. So another possibility for that increased shedding is, as people were hanging out at home, not perhaps shampooing their head on a regular basis, your hair follicle is cycling. And so if you shampoo regularly, the hairs that are going to fall out on that particular day that you shampoo are going to come out in your shampoo or with washing or brushing. And if you don't shampoo for several days, those fibers are going to stick in those follicles. And then when you do shampoo, you're going to have a lot more shedding. So perhaps that was part of the explanation, as well as the fact that scalp hygiene may not have been as good as it should have been during the pandemic. So to understand all this even more, let's just talk about the scalp and what it looks like. So this is a biopsy from a normal 23-year-old, in this case, Caucasian female. And you can see these long follicles going down to the very bottom of this slide. So the bulb is down in the fat. And if you look in the upper part, you can barely see them, but there are these oil glands or sebaceous glands. And those are the ones that produce sebum and can make your skin feel oily. And they're up there, and then you still have some sweat glands that are hanging out around the hair follicle more in the middle part. And if we can go to the next slide. When you look at a normal scalp and you look at it in cross-section, you see these healthy hair follicles because the majority of the scalp hair follicles are going to look like this, going to be like round donuts that are fairly uniform in size. You can see at 12 o'clock, you have some transition going on, but that would be expected because we all have follicles that are going through the growth phase, the loss phase, the regrowth phase. And so we expect to see some change in this cross section. And now let's go to the next slide. And here we see a biopsy from someone who's had long-standing alopecia areata. You can barely see the follicles in the middle of these units, of these clusters. But what you really see are a lot of oil glands or sebaceous glands. They're very, very prominent. So prior to some of these newer medications coming out on the market and our ability to prescribe them, this type of biopsy was met with, oh dear, what can we do? Whereas now we go, hey, we do have tools that could possibly work here. But again, this is just showing you that the scalp, the skin, it's dynamic. It's not static. So let's go to the next slide. So in 2024, we don't always have to do biopsies to look at scalp health. We can use AI technology, and this is a device called Hair Metrics, and it's shown here on the right. So it's a handheld device, and you place it on the scalp, and you can get an idea of how healthy a person's scalp is. And I have to admit, we haven't really done this a lot in patients with alopecia areata, but I'm going to show you a particular patient, actually one that I showed you earlier and what we saw, and just show you what this technology can do. The other thing that's happening out there is individuals, we all can go to Amazon and buy a device that magnifies, and there are ones that are actually now designed for the scalp. So you could purchase something from Amazon, put it on your scalp and get a good feel for your own scalp health and hair density. Those columns on this picture show the diameter of the hair fibers. So the red reflects very thin, fine fibers, the kind you can barely see when you look at someone unless you have angled light. And then the yellow are more intermediate in size. And then the green and dark green reflect more normal fibers being produced by that hair follicle. So let's go to the next slide. So I just want to share with you some pictures that we can get. These are just examples. So what we do right now is we look at the scalp health in the front, the middle, the vertex region where people get male pattern baldness, the back of the head and the temples. And you can see that this particular individual has a pretty healthy scalp, but there are some areas, like in this case, it's in one of the temples where there's some, I'll call it debris, maybe it's product. You can also see in that panel number 5 that there's some patchy pinkness, and you can see there's some inflammation where the hair comes out of the skin. So let's go to the next slide. So here we see that in almost every area of the scalp that we looked at it with that device, which magnifies about 15 times, that there is something going on around those fibers, particularly again in number 5, where one sees scale hugging that hair fiber as it comes out of the skin, but then you also have a lot of loose material on the scalp. So again, that could be product, it could be dandruff. You don't really know just looking at this, but it raises in our eyes that the suspicion that that scale really doesn't belong there. It's probably impacting how the person is responding to hair growth therapies. And so we always want to work on getting a better and healthier scalp. We can go to the next slide. So let's go back to this patient. So here she is. Remember, she's got that stuff on her hair, 12 o'clock. She has these red spots. So we're going to apply this technology to her scalp and let's take a look. And we're just going to look at one particular area. We can go to the next slide. And you can see here that on the left, which is her frontal scalp area. And remember, this is a patient with alopecia areata who's starting to grow hair back, but it's slow in coming, and it's a very diffuse pattern of regrowth. But when that probe was put on the front of her head, you can see all the little red hair, the little red marks. Those are all little baby fibers or vellus fibers that are less than 30 microns. As we go into the middle of her scalp on the top of the head, we start to see a bit more normal hair growth. And the scalp looks like it's a little pink, particularly at 6 o'clock. And then when we go to that vertex region or crown region, then we start to see again, much more of that redness and scale around where the hair fiber comes out of the skin. And we can go to the next slide. So the conclusion is at the present time that an unhealthy scalp may lead to unhealthy hair. And clinically, we've thought that for quite some time. It's just that there hasn't been a lot of data to support that clinical observations. So the scalp conditions that have been studied for hair impacts include like dandruff. Seborrheic dermatitis is an extension of dandruff. That's when people see inflammation and scale, not only on their face, but they can see it around their eyebrows, around their nose, and they can even have it on their chest. Or people who have contact or irritant dermatitis, again, from something applied to the scalp where it gets irritated and red, or they have atopic dermatitis or eczema. So we know probably more about scalp conditions with this group of conditions than we do at the present time for alopecia areata, which allows one to really prepare for the future to look at this a little bit more. So let's go to the next slide. So we know that the prevalence of dandruff, and this slide is courtesy of colleagues at CeraVe, and some of you might actually use CeraVe products on a regular basis. But in this particular slide, you can see that dandruff is supposedly more commonly seen in men compared to women. And you can see the dandruff sufferers by age that 46% are at ages like say 14 to 34, then 33%, 35 to 54, 55 plus 17%. So it's something you see across the age spectrum. We can go to the next slide. So what do people think is happening in dandruff? The skin has a barrier function, and you know, if you look at your skin, there's a barrier there. Things don't really easily get into the skin unless you have eczema or a rash. And the same is true for the scalp. So in number one, there's a healthy scalp skin barrier, and it could be disrupted. It could be disrupted by getting a sunburn on your scalp. It could be disrupted because you put a chemical on your skin that your skin did not like, whether you have hair or you don't have hair. It could be disrupted because the microbiome of your scalp is not completely normal. So a disrupted skin barrier provides favorable conditions for this yeast, malassezia, which is the yeast that's been said to belong to and create and cause seborrheic dermatitis or dandruff, to overpopulate on the skin. And then it metabolizes sebum or oil that disrupts that skin barrier, that scalp barrier even more. And then you get this inflammatory process. So for anyone on this webinar who's had dandruff or the diagnosis of seborrheic dermatitis, frequently you're prescribed an anti-inflammatory product, you're prescribed a shampoo that works on that fungus on our skin, and this problem can be controlled. And the thinking is that inflammatory process subsides and the barrier becomes more normal. So we can go to the next slide. So people have studied this, particularly in companies that make hair care products, shampoos. So in this particular study that was published in the International Journal of Dermatology a while ago, patient or individuals with dandruff were using a shampoo with ZPT or a non-medicated product for 3 weeks. And then they looked at flaking scores, and biopsies were taken at lesional areas where the disease was and at the end of the study to look at what happens in the skin under the microscope. And they also looked at that very top layer for evaluation of biochemical markers, and they compared. So let's take a look at what was found. We'll go to the next slide. So in this slide, the red bar reflects a particular inflammatory marker, and you can see in the patient with dandruff, it's much higher than in the non-dandruff scalp. And then you can also see on the right is the same thing for another inflammatory marker called interleukin 8. And when they look at biomarkers of barrier integrity, that top layer of the skin, once again, there are issues with that integrity when you look at the patient who has dandruff. So we can go look at the next slide now. So what about scalp psoriasis? That's another disease where people know more about what's going on in the scalp. But a lot of times when it's very early, it can just be misdiagnosed as dandruff. And the other thing is there are patients who have both alopecia areata and scalp psoriasis. And if everyone remembers way back when, that was one of the first cases that was highlighted in terms of the JAK inhibitors in a patient with alopecia areata and both psoriasis. So a review of the literature has shown that if you have psoriasis or scalp inflammation, the hair that's produced by the follicle is smaller in diameter. It has more surface pitting. The cuticle is not particularly normal. And hairs obtained were thinner than those from a normal group. So let's go to the next slide. So dandruff and seborrheic dermatitis are related. There's just something not quite right going on in the skin. And so oleic acid can induce flaking in the absence of that yeast called malassezia in susceptible individuals. So that's a particular acid that's produced in the skin that if you just have that overproduced, it can induce flaking. But again, the scalp barrier, if it's not normal, you have this dysfunction, it could be responsible for how one person responds to that oleic acid and another person doesn't, their skin is fine and they handle it quite well. And this comes back to a lot of the different topical products found in skincare products and scalp care products as the world begins to look at different oils and look at other caffeine and other things that are being put into different shampoos and conditioners these days. So let's go to the next slide. So this is talking about scalp contact dermatitis, and that picture on the right is showing someone has very, very thick scale. But going back to that patient with alopecia areata who wears that hairpiece with that contact of the metal clip to her skin, and her skin is showing pinkness there, patients do get allergic to things, and inflammation is a common sign. So if you think about that and you think about seborrheic dermatitis and you think about those acne lesions forming in some patients with people experiencing alopecia areata, and you're thinking about success with the treatments that we have, you don't want this. You want to get rid of all this inflammation so that the hair follicle can actually respond to the medications that are so targeting that inflammation present around the bottom part of the hair follicle. So remember, wigs and clips can induce an irritant or contact dermatitis, and hair products could also trigger a contact dermatitis. Next slide. So then there's this idea that sunlight, so for example, ultraviolet radiation induces chemical insults. Pollutants could do that. Other oxidizing hair colorants could do that. And what this is trying to say, is if you have all this damage going on to the skin, you're just not going to produce a normal hair fiber. And likewise, down below in the skin, and you can see the skin picture there on your right, you could have light going down perhaps a little bit further. You could have pollutants, irritants, changes in microbes, all of which are affecting that basic structure, like the hair follicle, and affecting it in a way that the hair fiber that it produces may not be completely normal. So in alopecia areata, when one has these very, very small fibers that are trying to express themselves and differentiate into normal fibers, you really want that scalp to be as healthy as can be because this is for the normal person. And so here in alopecia areata, we really want to protect the skin, keep it healthy so that the environment is the best possible for hair growth. Next slide, please. So this is just another study we'll quickly go over, and that is a study that was published in the International Journal of Cosmetic Science, where they wanted to characterize the top layer of the skin in people at dandruff compared to healthy scalp skin and to evaluate potential mechanisms. And so they took these skin biopsies from the scalp from 22 healthy female subjects and 21 dandruff sufferers from affected or lesional and unaffected or non-lesional sites. And then they these samples were studied. So we'll go on and take a look at what they found. We can go to the next slide. So on the left is normal, and you can see that up on the top, you have the stratum corneum, that's a very fine pink area, and then you see the epidermis. And if you go to non-lesional skin and the person has dandruff, you can see there are more pink, or there are more blue cells on the upper top. In the top there, you see that epidermis is thicker. And then if you go look at the person who has dandruff, then there is this proliferation of cells and more inflammation. Again, showing the effect of this inflammatory process on the skin. And likewise, they were able to demonstrate that there were many more proliferating cells in the person in panel C, as an example, compared to B and A. And we can go to the next slide. And this is just that picture that shows those little circles that are staining. So in the healthy scalp, you see a little bit. In the dandruff non-lesional scalp, you might see a little bit more. And then in the dandruff lesional scalp, these cells are staining with a marker called Ki67, which reflects a lot of proliferation basically going on in the upper layer of the skin, the epidermis. So a lot of science that I'm sharing with you guys tonight, but I think it's important to understand what people know and really appreciate how important that top layer of the skin is to keep it intact and keep it healthy. Next slide, please. So then let's talk about this yeast, that malassezia. So there's the sebum that comes out of those sebaceous glands, and it produces fatty acids from the triglycerides, and unsaturated fatty acids alter the skin barrier and induce inflammation. Let's go to the next slide. So dandruff is associated with these interactions between you, the person, and the microorganisms on your skin. And again, studies looked at physiological conditions that were highly relevant to the host age and varied in different regions of the same scalp. So if you look at microbiome studies of the scalp, one will see different data if you're looking at an area behind the ear or the top of the head or the back of the head. And what they saw, that bacteria had a stronger relationship with the severity of dandruff than fungi. So their conclusion in this paper, which was in Scientific Reports, was adjusting the balance of the bacteria on the scalp, enhancing one that's commonly on the skin called proteobacterium, and suppressing staphylococcus might be a potential solution to lessen that dandruff. All right, next slide. So that brings us coming to an end here, to think about the skin microbiome, the gut microbiome, and alopecia areata. And just to share with you, one of the projects that we're working on with Dr. Angela Cristiano from Columbia University is to really take a look at gut or transplantation or microbiota transplant therapy for alopecia areata. And we know from a meeting held in Spain a couple of weeks ago that colleagues in Croatia, in Spain, are also looking at different aspects of this. And where this comes from is microbiome transplants. Like if you start, like the way it all started, it was actually like a fecal transplant, but now everything is in a nice capsule, has shown to be effective in treating a gastrointestinal disease called C. diff infection. And there's been data to suggest benefit in autoimmune diseases such as lupus, and studies are ongoing right now with another dermatologic disease called hidradenitis suppurativa. Next slide. So this idea that the microbiome is not, it's in dysbiosis in alopecia areata has been suggested for quite some time. So preclinical studies in mice have documented changes, and in human alopecia areata patients, there's an overrepresentation of certain bacteria, some of which have also been shown to be overrepresented in celiac disease, type 2 diabetes, and rheumatoid arthritis. And for those of you who are following the genetics of alopecia areata from the GWAS studies done many years ago now, the same genes that are involved in alopecia areata are also playing a role in rheumatoid arthritis, but and also type 1 diabetes, not type 2, as noted in this particular slide. And then let's go to the next slide. So the hypothesis is, you know, can we influence the course of alopecia areata by administering microbiome transplant therapy? And that's what colleagues in Europe are aiming for, describing and finding out. Here, our clinical trial design, and we do have an IND from the FDA. We're still waiting for complete institutional review board approval. But here we're trying to see the possibility of a skin-gut axis in the pathogenesis or cause of alopecia areata, whereby changes in the gut microbiome may contribute to disease onset, progression, and remission. And we can go to the next slide. So our primary endpoint is to evaluate, does that transplant engraft into the gut? That's our primary endpoint. The secondary endpoint is to figure out whether the microbiome transplantation therapy influences the course of alopecia areata, and will also be looking at any changes on the microbiome of the scalp in different regions. Next slide, please. So just to kind of give you a background on this, so liquid colonoscopy materials were utilized early on when this type of approach was utilized in medicine or started. And then in 2015 and marching into 2024, the contents are now in nice capsules. So they look rather aesthetically pleasing. And these capsules, in this case, the five capsules in the hand, there contain like 500 to 700 billion microbes as compared to what you might see in a typical probiotic sample. And we can go on to the next slide. So I'd like to conclude with this picture. This is using technology from a company called Alpenglow, where they are able to take, when you do a scalp biopsy and you put it in formalin, in that fixative that's used, they can actually take that biopsy sample and clear it, and using technology and stains, create 3D images like this one. So you're seeing at the top, the epidermis coming into play. And then soon here, there we go. The long structures again are those hair follicles. The green lines at the top are the nerves below the epidermis. And then in blue, we have a lot of inflammatory cells present in this particular sample. Next slide, please. So I hope I've taken you on a journey of scalp health, the things that people are paying attention to. And I am ready to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Dr. Hordinsky. Great information. And we've gotten a lot of questions, so I'll get started. Is there any known scalp or hair follicle benefit associated with periodic total hair removal?
So that question is an interesting one for alopecia areata. I think I have to think about that question a little bit, because when I first heard it, I was thinking of a different hair disease where the inflammation targets the stem cell region of the hair follicle, where there's permanent injury. And in that particular type of hair loss, removing the hair is actually a treatment for some patients. In alopecia areata, if someone has, you know, extensive patchy disease and they want to shave the rest of their hair, then that's fine, because if you want to look like you have no hair, it's better to do that perhaps for some people than is to have multiple patches. At the same time, how you remove that hair becomes important, because remember, we spent a lot of time talking about intact upper layer, intact barrier. So some people, if they use a straight edge razor or such, it's just too close to the skin and it's going to disrupt it. So you have to think about how you're going to do that if you're going to do that. So that would be my answer to that one.
Thank you. The next one is, how can I find out what kind of alopecia I have, and what do I moist in my scalp with?
So those are all good questions too. So earlier today, the coders in our practice plan, there seemed to be about 200 or 300 of them, we did an informational session on alopecia, because our coders also have to learn some of this language. And it's so fascinating with the word alopecia, because it just means hair loss, that there are so many different types. So you saw pictures at the beginning of this presentation of the many presentations of scalp alopecia areata. if you find yourself having something that looks really red and irritated and has pimples surrounding it, it's probably not alopecia areata. So it'd be very good to have someone take a look at it, preferably a dermatologist who understands hair diseases. So that would be the first answer and first piece of advice.
Okay. Here's another good one. Should I be putting anti-wrinkle cream on my scalp just as I do on my face?
That's such a great question. So people are putting tretinoin or Retin-A on their hands when they're with aging of the hands, they're putting that on their face. It has been used in scalp and hair conditions as a way, the argument has been that if you put something like tretinoin on your scalp or a vitamin A derived drug, and then you put a medicine on there like topical minoxidil, that you could increase the penetration of minoxidil into the skin. But in general, at this point in time, most people are not using topical tretinoin on their scalp at this point.
Okay. And then we have one here about products. Are there any products that you would recommend for shampoo or conditioner or leave-in conditioner?
So that comes back to scalp health again. It's in our practice, if someone has limited patchy disease, we treat it, say, with intralesional injections or topical steroids. If someone has patches that come and go and they're present all over the head and there might be multiple patches, then we tend to use a shampoo that has a steroid in it. It's called Clovex or it's clobetasol as a steroid, but the brand name is Clovex. And that's when you put on a dry scalp. So we really don't know when we look at the scalp of someone who has patchy disease, if they're going to get a new patch tomorrow, a week from now, or 2 months from now. So we have convinced ourselves that if you treat the whole scalp with something like Clovex shampoo, that you are treating the entire scalp, not just the patches. And then we monitor clinically. There also is a tricky variant of alopecia areata. It's called the diffuse variant. And many women in particular get misdiagnosed as having pattern hair loss or like female pattern baldness. And if you're doing things and nothing's getting better, then sometimes it's good to do a biopsy and see if there's alopecia areata present. Because in that case, the hair follicle is targeted, but not in a circle. It's like targeted here, here, here. So you get rid of, or not you won't get rid of them, but you minimize the presence on the surface of the skin of a lot of those follicles. So there's a decrease in density. So that's another place where that particular shampoo works or can work.
Okay, great. Here's another one on scalp care. Is there any difference in your scalp care recommendation based on age? I'm 66 and I quickly lost all my hair this year.
So no, we do not discriminate between the two-year-old and someone, you know, the oldest patient I had in the practice was in her mid-90s. And there is, at this point with topical treatment, there is no discrimination in terms of the medications that one may choose. You would figure this out on an individual basis. Something else to consider, if you think about dry skin, so yes, we live in a world of climate change. And so last year here in Minnesota, we had a very mild winter. Who knows what will happen this year? But when the winters that we're used to is they're really cold and your skin gets dry and so does your scalp. And so it is not uncommon, in fact, it's more common than not, to recommend to everybody who has some type of hair problem and there's dryness, something's going on in the scalp, to use an oil at least once a week at a minimum. So we'll prescribe a medicated oil that people will apply once a week to the entire head starting from November till about April. But again, things are changing in the world that we live in. So that use of oil in primarily Caucasian patients using it that way may change. In individuals who are used to using oils, it's great because we can have the patient use that oil product that has a medicine in it more frequently.
Okay, great. And I know there was a question about oils. If there is a topical oil to put on the scalp to relieve the itching, is this typically an over-the-counter oil or is this, you mentioned, one that is prescribed?
So the one that's prescribed is called fluocinolone oil. So it has a mid-strength steroid in it. There are so many oils out there. And a couple of years ago, one of our colleagues who's now a dermatology resident published a paper called Hairfluencer Social Media Trends Every Dermatologist Should Know in 2021. And that covers a lot of the oils like castor oil and pumpkin seed oil and rosemary oil. When we talk about oils and someone is averse to using steroids, or even if they aren't, of the literature that we know and the studies that have been done, they're few and far between, but rosemary oil does come out as a winner. So that is something that we will recommend to patients. But again, if you're using an oil and your scalp starts to get pimples, then you overshot with that oil. You're now causing plugging, which is going to work against the management of someone who has alopecia areata.
Okay, well, this is perfect for the next question, talking about pimples. How can I stop pimples on my scalp? I wash my hair once every 2 weeks, shots 4 to 6 weeks, and minoxidil.
Yeah, that one's a tricky one. What the person didn't tell us is, do they go to the gym every day? Do they lift weights? Does their head really sweat? Do they, you know, bicycle 50 miles every weekend or whatever? So it really depends on your activity level. If you find yourself sweating a lot and your scalp is getting really sweaty, then you need to shampoo more frequently. Sweat contains chemicals as well. And when those chemicals get on the skin of certain people, they can be irritating. So again, that barrier we spent a lot of time talking about could be, I don't want to say destroyed, but it would be altered at least. So it's important to keep that scalp healthy by figuring out, how frequently do you have to shampoo to keep that skin barrier intact and so that those pimples don't form? Now, if you're someone who has a lot of pimples on the scalp, that does happen to some people, then sometimes you have to turn to actually using products that work on acne, like even a benzoyl peroxide wash, which hopefully in alopecia areata you do not need to do.
Okay. I know you touched briefly on JAKs, and how do you avoid folliculitis on your scalp while taking a JAK inhibitor?
So that's what the interesting part of all of this is in our practice and in our clinical research studies, we really never saw people get a lot of folliculitis or pimples on the scalp. If we saw acne, it was on the face. So I think this is something we're going to have to watch and learn more about, because if the acne, the percentage of patients in the clinical trials who developed acne, and it turned out being something that stood out on the radar screen, was around 5.8 or 5.96%. If that's true, then we have to still all learn what happens to that acne as you continue on a JAK inhibitor and you get older. Like, what happens to it? Does it get better? Did your skin get accustomed to it? And why that acne or that folliculitis isn't forming as much on the scalp compared to the face? I don't think I have a good answer for that.
Okay, thank you. Another one here, it's what can be done to improve the scalp microbiome, and will over cleansing damage it?
Good, great question. So I'm not sure that we have all the data to answer that question. People right now are using so many different products, and a lot of people are getting their products from the internet because they're natural. But then when we ask them for the name, and then we'll go Google it in their clinic visit, and we'll see that the list of ingredients is literally like 10 lines long. So, whatever we're doing, when we put those kind of chemicals on our scalp, is probably not well understood, even though the majority are natural. So in people with sensitive skin, we try to reduce the number of chemicals that are being applied in a shampoo or a conditioner product. And for dandruff, there are a couple that are really used a lot. One is called ketoconazole and one is called cyclopirox. So today, I got a message from a person who's a PhD in a laboratory and runs a very sophisticated lab. Ketoconazole had been recommended, and they went through the list of ingredients and said, nope, that one's not good. This is like, it has red dye in it, that's bad. So one has to really look at these products that are either being promoted in social media or promoted in articles, or even the ones that we're all used to prescribing, and really take a look at what's being applied to the scalp, because whatever we're doing on the outside is going to alter that microbiome. So unless you do good, clean studies, I don't know if we'll be able to answer that question accurately.
Okay. And with that said, a lot of our questions that are coming in are about products, you know, cleansing the microbiome, the scalp, and preserving it. Are there any products that you would recommend? Or if not, why not?
So I think you heard a little bit about products we would not recommend. And that would be if the product ingredient list is long, then it may not be the right product for someone who has an autoimmune disease of the skin. Even though the inflammation is lower in the skin, probably the best thing to do is to stay with pretty basic chemicals in a skincare product as a shampoo or a conditioner. Now, again, none of this has really been studied well. This is kind of coming from clinical practice and seeing what we see with our patients. So in addition to cyclopirax and ketoconazole, a lot of anti-dandruff shampoos have zinc. We covered one of those in the presentation. So Head and Shoulders has zinc in it. There's a great product for people with sensitive skin called DHS zinc. Again, not many chemicals in it. Vanicream zinc. There are a lot of products out there where the ingredient list isn't huge, and they have the right products for good, or the right chemicals for good scalp health.
Those products, would it be any different for those for teenagers? Somebody asked, are there products that you would recommend specifically for a teenage boy?
Right. Well, we would probably recommend the same product. And okay. We saw the young man with acne and also some seborrheic dermatitis. However, I do work in an institution where our head of pediatric dermatology developed a skincare line for teenage boys. And if you go on social media, you will find that particular line. And I haven't actually carefully examined it in terms of what do they really have for scalp? I think they focus more on teenage boys who have acne.
Okay. And from those products that you mentioned, are any of those hypoallergenic products that you recommend, or any that you recommend?
Yes, some would be considered hypoallergenic.
Okay.
So, like the DHA zinc, for example, or the Vanicream zinc. But again, if you have very sensitive skin, or if you have eczema, it doesn't matter. Sometimes something that is considered to be safe for sensitive skin, you may find you can't tolerate it, but someone else might.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. We have a lot of questions coming in, so we're still sorting through some of these. But so somebody mentioned mentioned about shampoos with biotin. Are there any that you feel are good now to utilize?
There are a lot of shampoos out there in the market with biotin in them, but there are really very few studies that carefully look at a shampoo with different vitamins like biotin in them and taking a good look at what happens to scalp microbiome, as well as, in this case, alopecia areata. It's a little bit of a different story for biotin and vitamins taken by mouth, because if you take something orally, you want to make sure that you don't over-treat. So we have a lot of people right now that are taking Vivascal or Nutrafol plus a daily multivitamin. And sometimes what happens is vitamin D levels go up too high. Sometimes vitamin E levels can go too high. And these are not, that's not good for you. And perhaps like in vitamin E, if it's too high, you can actually shed hair. And this goes back to diffuse hair shedding. How that would impact alopecia areata, I don't think we really know.
Okay, thank you. And we do have over 150 people online. So a lot of questions keep coming in. Thank you. It's very useful information. So thank you for taking the time to answer all of these. We have another question. It's how likely is it that we will see a gut microbe treatment in the future?
How likely is it that we'll see a gut?
Yes.
I hope that we'll know in a couple of years. That's my optimistic hope, so to speak. I think that it's been a long journey to get some of these microbiome studies off the ground and having the funding to do it. But the fact that just learning a couple of weeks ago that this approach is being looked at more than just our institution is really exciting, because that means we're all going to learn, whether you live in Spain or the United States or in Croatia. It's going to be great.
Absolutely. Thank you. We have another question. Does coloring your hair cause the alopecia to become worse?
I don't think I would say the direct answer is no. However, if you are sensitive or allergic to a chemical within that hair product, that hair dye product, and it irritates your skin, then you could make things worse potentially. But remember, it wasn't that long ago where we were using allergic contact dermatitis to change the immune system in the skin. We were making people allergic to a chemical. So there's this fine balance between inflammation that causes trouble and inflammation which grows hair. And if you have inflammation on your scalp and now you're going to use a hair dye or put something on it, it probably isn't going to feel very good and it may make things worse.
Okay. And I think we have time for one more question before we have to wrap it up. But is there any research looking at topical antioxidants for alopecia areata?
Oh, yeah, that's a great one. So, you know, there's that picture of the hair follicle and the hair fiber sticking out, and there's the sunlight hitting it. You're going to get a lot of oxidative damage. So you want to do something to quench that. And so if you take a look at some of the conditioners that are out there, or even some of the newer products, people are thinking that way of putting something in there that's going to act as an antioxidant. But at the end of the day, make sure you don't get a sunburn on your head. You know, really be careful about, well, there's not a lot you can do sometimes about pollutants, but just being watchful.
Great. Well, thank you, Dr. Hordinsky. We'll wrap this up and I'm going to share my screen again with everyone. Thank you again to Dr. Hordinsky and to the audience for joining us today. Please share your feedback on today's webinar and help us plan future presentations. A link to a short survey will pop up on your browser window at the end of the webinar, and your feedback is appreciated. Dr. Hordinsky, I'm sure you're feeling the love. You're seeing
all of this. I see a lot of love and a lot of thumbs up.
So thank you for all your work that you're doing.
Thank you for everyone's attention to listen to this topic, which is not straightforward.
Yes. And join us for our next webinar, Alopecia Areata Treatment Update 2024, with the third treatment approval for severe alopecia areata in 2024. It's time for an update on these approved medications. Dr. Marianne Senna, Director of Beth Israel Lahey Health Hair Loss Center of Excellence, will discuss the latest on the current treatments landscape for alopecia areata, including what we've learned from clinical trial results and navigating treatment discussions with your dermatologist. And there's a lot happening at NAF. How can you keep up? Subscribe to our email list and get regular updates on breaking alopecia areata news and research, our monthly NAF electronic newsletter, along with notices about upcoming webinars and other programs. If you are not on our list, please scan the QR code here to enter your email address to receive our emails. And as promised, here are the resources from NAF. Don't forget, we offer a number of resources and programs to the alopecia areata community, including support groups, our youth mentor and legislative liaison programs, our doctor finder, clinical trial listing, as well as news and webinar links and how to get involved. To learn more about NAF and the resources we offer, please visit NAF.org or email us at support@NAF.org. And this concludes today's webinar program. Thank you again, Dr. Hordinsky. Thank you all for joining us. We look forward to seeing you on the next webinar.